The state of Colorado begins a hearing to determine if former U.S. President Donald Trump should be disqualified from the 2024 ballot. A group of voters cited Trump's major role in the deadly attack on the U.S. Capitol that was aimed at keeping him in office. In an attempt to keep him off the ballot, the group used a Civil War-era provision of the U.S. Constitution, barring those who engage in insurrection or rebellion from holding federal office.
Trump incited a violent mob to attack our Capitol to stop the peaceful transfer of power under our Constitution. That mob got within 40 feet of Vice President Pence after they chased him from the Senate floor. That mob tried to hurt and kill our elected leaders. And we are here because Trump claims, after all that, he has the right to be president again. But our Constitution, our shared charter of our nation, says he cannot do so. And Colorado law says this court must ensure that only eligible candidates appear on our ballots.
The Colorado case is the first to go to trial among similar lawsuits brought by advocacy groups in many U.S. states. U.S. President Joe Biden signs an executive order addressing the risks of artificial intelligence. The move is the latest step by the Biden administration to set parameters around AI. The order requires developers of AI systems to share the results of safety tests with the U.S. government before they are released to the public. U.S. agencies are also now required to set standards for the testing and address related cybersecurity risks.
This executive order will use the same authority to make companies prove that their most powerful systems are safe before allowing them to be used. That means companies must tell the government about the large-scale AI systems they're developing and share rigorous independent test results to prove they pose no national security or safety risk to the American people.
Let's find out what stories our North America Bureau is pursuing right now from our Bureau Chief, TJ Manoto.
Good morning to our friends at The Rundown. Here are the top stories in the North American region. We begin in Vancouver, Canada, where nearly 100 Filipino-Canadians were honored as Golden Ears as they paved the way for thousands more Filipino migrants finding a new life in Canada.
Some of the pioneers of Filipino migration to Canada gathered recently to celebrate 50-plus years of living in Canada. Fondly called the Golden Years, early immigrants from the 60s and 70s reconnected and shared stories of struggles and triumphs. One of these Golden Years is Elizabeth Valenciano Cruz, who followed her sisters to Canada.
We promise that maybe after 50 years, God willing, we will be able to do a reunion. This is a very memorable time for us.
Burnaby Councilor Maita Santiago paid tribute to the early pioneers.
Napakalaking bagay yung ginawa nila, no? Na pag-immigrate here those many years ago. At pati na din yung pagsikap nila na ensure na yung Filipino community and our culture lives on.
Over in Los Angeles, PhilAMS gathered to honor some of the community's best and most influential as they celebrated Filipino-American History Month. Among the honorees, award-winning veteran journalists Jing Reyes and Jessica Soho, as well as former Vice President Lenny Robredo.
It was a star-studded affair in downtown Los Angeles as the outstanding Filipino awards honored Filipinos from the U.S. and all over the world. Former Philippine Vice President Lenny Robredo was one of the top honorees as she reminded PhilAMS to never forget to help the homeland.
I hope that each of us here tonight in this hall will remember our collective responsibility to orient ourselves towards the welfare of our countrymen, to look after the last, the least, and the lost of our brothers and sisters here, back home, and elsewhere. To channel our strengths and talents, not only to make our nation proud, but to reach the future of our hopes.
California Attorney General Rob Bonta graced the event to honor the awardees as well. For Reyes, she thanked her former team at ABS-CBN News for all their contributions that made her career as impactful and memorable.
I cannot accept this award without giving credit to my entire news team in ABS-CBN. It was their hard work and sacrifice and steadfast support that made me strong enough to withstand and survive the extreme challenges we all faced, especially in the last 3 years. I am humbled by this honor.
And over in Alberta, 12 candidates competed in the first ever Teen and Miss Multicultural Beauty pageant held in Red Deer.
Abigail Cabrera!
Friends and relatives of the contestants for the Miss Teen and Miss Multicultural Beauty pageant showed up to an evening of elegance and glamour at Red Deer's Festival Hall.
This is my dream, and this is my passion. It's not about business, it's about me helping this young generation to be, to build their confidence.
Contestants age 14 to 27 vied for the coveted beauty titles. 21-year-old Emmanuel Llarenas emerged as the winner of Miss Multicultural 2023.
It wasn't the easiest journey, but it became easy because of the help of my friends and especially my family. It was a long process, but all I can say is that it is worth it.
16-year-old Abigail Cabrera bagged the title of Miss Teen Multicultural 2023.
It feels so surreal because it's my first pageant and I didn't really expect to win.
And those are the top stories making the headlines amongst the Filipino community in North America. You can catch more of our TFC News on our website, news.abs-cbn.com/TFC News, on the ABS-CBN News YouTube channel, and on the ABS-CBN News app for your smartphones and tablets. Back to our friends at the Rundown.
Israel shutting the door for a ceasefire in their raging war against Hamas militants. Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu says this is a time for war and Israel will not agree to any truce. For Netanyahu, agreeing to a ceasefire means surrendering to terrorism.
Just as the United States would not agree to a ceasefire after the bombing of Pearl Harbor or after the terrorist attack of 9/11, Israel will not agree to a cessation of hostilities with Hamas after the horrific attacks of October 7th. Calls for a ceasefire are calls for Israel to surrender to Hamas, to surrender to terrorism, to surrender to barbarism. That will not happen.
Netanyahu also justifies a looming ground invasion of Gaza, saying it could force Hamas to release more hostages.
The ground action actually creates the possibility, not the certainty, but the possibility of getting our hostages out, because Hamas will not do it unless they're under pressure. They simply will not do it. They only do it under pressure. This creates pressure. We're committed to getting all the hostages back home. We think that this method stands a chance. It's a goal that we're committed to.
More than 8,000 Palestinians have been killed as Israel continues to pound Gaza with airstrikes in retaliation to the deadly October 7 attack of Hamas. Israeli troops also advancing deeper into the besieged enclave for their ground invasion. A female Israeli soldier freed from Hamas captivity in the Gaza Strip during a military ground operation. The military identified the soldier as Ori Megidish. She had undergone checkups and is reportedly doing well. No details were given on the circumstances of her release. While Hamas releases a new video showing three women hostages, one of the hostages sent a message to Netanyahu asking him to take them home in an exchange for Palestinian prisoners. Israel says around 230 people were abducted by Hamas. For the relatives of the hostages, the video gives them hope that their loved ones are still alive.
It feels good to know that some of them are okay. I can't say what this video means, but to see that there's a chance that our beloved people are alive, it does feel good.
It gives us a lot of hope to see that they're still alive. We haven't given up on them yet. We know they're alive and we're gonna do anything we can to bring them back. We're not gonna stop until we have a definite answer. Either here or there, we're gonna keep fighting until they're back home. Until there's peace between the people, we're not gonna stop.
The Philippine government struggles to reach some Filipinos in Gaza. Authorities say about 49 Filipinos are now unreachable. Dozens more also decry dwindling supply of food and water.
There are 9 Filipino nationals in Gaza City, which is now being hit, no? The 9 include 3 who definitely wanted to remain there, including one Filipina nun of the Missionaries of Charity. Sino tong 6? Bumalik sila from the south because they lacked space in the quarters they were staying. According to our embassy and the Filipinos, they have food, but access to potable water is getting difficult.
The Philippine government vows to exhaust all efforts to rescue the remaining Filipinos trapped in the enclave, but it has yet to support calls for a ceasefire in the Gaza Strip.
There was one very important issue that was not reflected, and that was a mention of the terrorist attacks on October 7, where in our case, 4 Filipinos were confirmed to have been killed. Nevertheless, there are many points which we have said that we supported in that resolution.
Meanwhile, the biggest batch of OFWs from Israel arrived in Manila on Monday. 32 of them are hotel workers, while 28 more are caregivers. Turkish President Tayyip Erdogan ramps up his support of Hamas, prompting Israel to withdraw its diplomats. More in this report.
At a mass rally in Istanbul Saturday, Turkish President Recep Tayyip Erdogan stepped up his support of Hamas, declaring again that Hamas is not a terrorist organization, but a liberation movement. The Turkish leader went on to warn that Turkey may come in the night to Gaza, with the crowd chanting to send the Turkish military. In response to Erdogan's statements, Israel has recalled its diplomats from Turkey, setting back the country's newly restored diplomatic relations.
I think such statements basically symbolize that the rapprochement is over. I think that's quite clear that this normalization process that started in 2022 is now over.
Last month in New York, Erdogan met for the first time with Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu. In the aftermath of Hamas's attack on Israel, Erdogan initially toned down his rhetoric as he sought to play a mediating role. But with Ankara appearing to be diplomatically sidelined, Erdogan stepped up his public support for Hamas.
He decided that it doesn't make any difference for his regional role, so he could play the domestic game instead of a futile attempt to be a mediator in this conflict.
With opposition parties in Turkey protesting nationwide against Israel's Gaza assault, Erdogan's escalating rhetoric is also seen as an attempt to avoid being politically outflanked and to keep his religious base on his side. But in a gesture to his Western allies, the Turkish leader last week sent to Parliament a bill for the ratification of Sweden's NATO membership, which Turkey has been delaying. Some experts claim Erdogan is seeking to perform a balancing act.
There he plays for the public, the local electorate, and the Muslim populations. And he's also giving something to the West with the with Sweden's NATO membership. But I don't think that would work that way, because he's making very, very fiery statements, bashing the U.S., bashing Israel. It's going far beyond that. It's advocating Hamas.
With Israeli forces stepping up their offensive in Gaza, experts say Israel has been measured in its response to Erdogan, with the priority being containment of the conflict.
Israel doesn't need to add to the current tense situation with its neighbors, also tensions with Turkey. So I think the Israeli government will do all its best not to enter into direct confrontation with Turkey. Yes, it will listen to the rhetoric very carefully, and it will see what Turkey does.
As the conflict escalates, Turkey's Western allies have largely ignored Erdogan's rhetoric. But some experts warn his words of support of Hamas are unlikely to be forgotten. Dorian Jones, VOA News, Istanbul.